Shawn, we've changed places. We've traded places. As I am now in Las Vegas and have been and will be for a while. And I believe you are back home in the comfort of maybe the office right now. I can't tell.
Dan, I don't have tiled ceilings in my house. So yes, I'm in the office for the only day. I'm back on the road, baby. I'm a road warrior. Carolina, here I come. The Pit, be having dinner there tomorrow night.
Well, look, we're down to four. You're going to hear from Dallas Eakins, a former coach of the Anaheim Ducks, joined us. And we went over the entire operation of the conference final with him. And really interesting stuff, especially from the coaches' aspect of these conference final, with Vegas and Dallas in the Western Conference final, and obviously Carolina and Florida in the Eastern Conference final. So that's coming up shortly here. But Shawn, let's get some of our thoughts on this. So we're down to four, started with 32. 16, 8, 4, here we go. And the four teams that we've got here, all of them have a lot of the similar traits, right? I mean, questions about goaltending. I mean, even Dallas had some questions about goaltending in their Seattle series with Jake Oettinger getting pulled twice. But getting by, lots of depth, good defense. When they're on, they're forechecking the heck out of you. There's a lot of similarities here between the four teams that are remaining. And I don't say this just because, you know, to be a company man or whatever. I honestly think that we could get the two of the best series that we've seen in these conference final, because the matchups, to me, they look so good. They're so juicy. And then, you know, you've got a lot of familiarity in how each coach operates as well. Pete DeBoer coached the Vegas Golden Knights, right? I mean, Paul Maurice coached Rod Brendamore. It is actually going to be, if John Stevens, now on the Vegas Golden Knights bench, he coached as an assistant with the Dallas Stars. It's going to be real interesting. I think we're going to get two fascinating series here that, you know, the East starts Thursday and the West Friday.
Yeah, no, they're going to be great, because in a lot of ways, the teams are mirror images of each other, right? You look at how they're broken down and they have a lot of the same traits, and then they have everybody has their difference makers, right? Like you look at Florida and it's Matthew Tkachuk, and there's nobody left in the tournament like him. Like he's just who he is, and you can't look at any other team and be like, oh, they have one of those, right? But then you look at Carolina and they have a Brent Burns, and maybe Miro Heiskanen's like that, and maybe Montour's like that, but they're not exactly the same, right? And then you look at Vegas and Jack Eichel. A month ago, I was in Vegas and I was writing, can Jack Eichel play in the playoffs? And his own coach had questions about it. He's like, look, some guys, it takes them a while. Playoffs are a different animal, and it takes players, good players, a while to figure it out. It hasn't taken Jack any time to figure it out. He's been spectacular. He's led that team between him and Mark Stone, right? So, like, I just look at each of these teams, and they have that unique piece that is like no other, but the rest of the surrounding pieces are very similar. So, you know, it could come down into individuals at some point, you know, with these teams being such good teams, who is going to step to the forefront. And it may not be any of the guys I mentioned. It may be a Barbashev. It may be, you know, a Sam Bennett. It may be a Wyatt Johnson, like it was in game 7 for Dallas, you know? So I think for 2 weeks, it's going to be riveting must see TV, and it's going to expose some teams that don't get enough exposure in our league. You know, I'll be the first one to say that they're not the teams that we always pay attention to. And we should, because they're fantastic teams. If you're a hockey fan, there's no way you don't enjoy the next 2 weeks.
You know, Shawn, I'm glad you brought up Eichel, because he's a player in the last couple of the games that I've covered for Vegas that I've really paid attention to. And, you know, you wonder, like, is he a superstar? Is he just a really good player? If he continues down this path, he's going to be approaching that superstardom area that he was brought into the league to be. But the way he holds onto pucks, the power game he plays, and how he impacts the game all over the ice, he's answering so many questions that you brought up, that we all brought up before the playoffs began. And I think that's one of the big things that this postseason is, a player like that, who has been a polarizing player in the league for his 8 seasons, is finally answering those questions.
Well, he's the man now, Dan, because he doesn't have to be the man. He has help. He has people around him who can insulate him, right? He has Mark Stone. He has the Misfits. Look at game six, right? The three Misfits, the original Misfits, Marchessault with the natural hat trick, Riley Smith scores, and William Karlsson scores. Like, he has help now. He never had help, or he didn't have enough help. So now he does, and now he can worry about what he has to do. He's not the focal point. Other people take that away for him. So, you know, he's done great for Vegas, but how many names did we just mention? And we haven't even got to their defensemen. To me, they're the most complete team left in the tournament and the favorite probably.
Yeah, I think they could be the favorite, although I do question if they can continue to ride it with Adin Hill. Honestly, like, and he was great. Like, he had made 38 saves in a row at the end of, you know, after allowing the first two goals in on the two shots, you know, in game six against Edmonton, he makes 38 saves in a row. He's been a wall. He's been terrific. And we'll touch on this with Dallas Eakins too. When we play that interview, Sean Burke, their goalie coach, director of goaltending, I should say, has done a masterful job with the goaltending. With Adin Hill has been terrific, but I wonder if they're going to ride that, if you can ride that all the way. Because what I saw from Jake Oettinger in game seven was the real Jake Oettinger, and he's the best goalie remaining. And no, it's not always that easy, but he's the best goalie remaining, and he's the guy that's going to be delivering all that confidence to the Dallas Stars.
Goaltending doesn't matter, not this year. Vegas' system is set up for plug and play with goalies. They used five this year, and they won with five. They won 51 games, and they used five goalies. You probably can't even name all of them. That's how deep they went into their goaltending pool, and they still won 51 games. So yep. I'm not concerned about Adin Hill. To me, the answer was, you just mentioned it. They walk into a crazy Edmonton building, crazy Edmonton on life support. The fans all over Vegas trying to will their team to a game seven, which at that point becomes a coin flip. They score the first goal. He gives up two goals, and you're like, oh my God. All they need now is a power play, and it's all over. They never scored again. They were desperate. They were desperate to score. They had power plays. They had opportunities. They were desperate to score, and they couldn't beat Adin Hill. Is there anybody left in this tournament, including Matthew Tkachuk, including Jason Robertson, including Sebastian Aho, that's as dangerous as Connor McDavid or Leon Draisaitl? No.
You're 100% right. They are, and they are – 5-on-5, they're a terrific team. They really are. Special teams game, not so great. Only 17% on the power play, 60% on the PK. So if they keep it 5-on-5 against Dallas, Dallas, by the way, is 30% or 31% on the power play and like 83% on the PK. So that's got to be a 5-on-5 series. All right, quickly, before we get to Dallas Eakins, one thought here on Florida and Carolina. Both teams got dispatched their opponents in the second round pretty quickly, five games. It's a lot of time off. Or you think there's going to be a little, are we talking about rest rust here with these two teams, or do they just come out firing in game one?
Well, it's equal. So that's one thing. There's no excuse built in. I think you need a short series. You know, we had Tripp Tracy on last week, a great interview. And he talked about how, you know, if you're going to win the cup, you need a short series to get better, to get healthy, to get a little bit of rest. So I don't think it affects them just because of the way that they play, right? It's literally, you know, go out and do the same things over and over. It's repetition. There's no robotic, I think is the term that Dallas Eakins will use when we go to this interview right now. So I don't see that. I think maybe, you know, a half period and you're off to the races. It didn't happen for Vegas, right? They had all that time off after they beat Winnipeg and showed no signs of it. So I'm not worried about that. I think that series is going to be absolutely riveting.
Yeah, I think so. I think we get two long series, but we talked about it enough. So Dallas Eakins was kind enough to join us. He's doing some media stuff, did some hockey night in Canada, did a little ESPN, former coach of the Anaheim Ducks. Here is that interview with Dallas Eakins. Dallas, thanks so much for joining us. Welcome to the podcast, by the way. Really appreciate you you jumping on with us. So what are your general impressions? We got four teams left here, Carolina, Florida, Vegas, Dallas. Just some general impressions of what you've seen from these teams, I guess.
Well, number one, thanks for having me. It's been an interesting playoff for sure. And you know what, these series are going to be decided by the players, but I do think there's some interesting things going on the coaching side, some interesting stories. Obviously, Pete DeBoer used to, and Steve Spott used to coach the Vegas Golden Knights. John Stevens used to be a coach with the Dallas Stars, and now they're on opposite benches. In the East, you know, Paul Maurice coached the Hurricanes twice. He actually coached Rod Brendamore. I know Paul very well. I know he's got a great love of Rod Brendamore. When we coached together in Toronto, he would speak about him constantly of his respect and Rod's work ethic. And so it's interesting, the matchups just like that. Coaches going against their old teams, coaches lined up against guys that they used to coach. And I think it'll be some interesting storylines there.
Dallas, you coach in what I guess we would term a non-traditional, you coach in a non-traditional market. You know, California's kind of become a little bit more mainstream. This is four kind of non-traditional markets, very southern. Vegas is the most northern team left in the Stanley Cup playoffs, which is kind of unbelievable. I'm just curious, you know, what does this Final Four say about the NHL and its attempts to grow the game in areas where we might not think of traditionally?
Yeah, like I think the NHL and Mr. Bettman there have done an incredible job growing our game, and it's ongoing. Like, it's never stopping. We do our best in the market that I've been in for a while to keep growing the game. But you see it going on in Arizona when we go in there, when we go into Dallas, when we go into Florida, these places, like, you see the minor hockey really stepping up. It's way more noticeable than it was, well, let's say even back when I was a player. So the game is growing. And the other part of this is when you see the markets that are left, they are passionate markets. Like, you know, Dallas has a real strong fan base. Carolina's building is hard to play in. Their fans are right on top of you. Vegas is, you know, they're out of their minds there. Now, Florida, it is a little bit different there. But I think they're going to do very, very well here in the playoffs with their fans. And then on the other side of it, the markets, especially the Canadian markets, I do believe there is something there that it takes a real special group to get through it with the amount of media that is out there on your team. But the social media, there's a lot of things pummeling these players. And I do think it makes it a little bit tougher to win.
You had brought up Pete DeBoer, obviously coaching against the Vegas Golden Knights. It was 1 year ago today, by the way, that he was let go by the Golden Knights. So those scars are still there. You know, the wounds might still be open a little bit. But this is four times now. He's taken four different teams to the conference final round. It was New Jersey, San Jose, Vegas, and now Dallas. And he does it right away with his teams. Is there something about Pete's style as a coach, from coach to coach, is there something about his style and what he can do early in his tenure that allows for this type of success right off the bat for the teams that he goes to?
Well, I don't know exactly how he coaches in his room, and nobody does unless you're in there. I don't know how he is with his team. I do know Pete personally. I do know that he's of high character, that he's got great values, he's a good family man, those things. And I do think those things have to come off of you in a dressing room. So I know his teams are well led that way. His teams are quite mechanical. And it's interesting. Like, when you look at there's parts of Vegas's game that are still that were instilled by Pete DeBoer. Like, they are still there. They're still using those systems on their breakouts. It's like what Cassidy left behind in Boston. There were things that Boston was still doing that Cassidy had left there. So I do agree with you. The wounds, they don't go away very quickly. And I think if you're a really competitive person, not that you're out for maybe revenge or anything like that, but you certainly have a long memory on if you felt like you've been slighted or maybe screwed over, you know, whatever that is. So I think for Pete and for and Steve Spott too, I think there's a little extra on the line for the coaches, for sure.
Dallas, I thought that was so interesting what you just said about the remnants of past coaches being part of teams' DNA. Is that something you have to do as a coach because of the way that teams are constructed when you inherit them, that in order to be successful, you kind of have to mix and match your philosophy with some of the DNA that's left from previous regimes?
I think you're smart. I think the biggest thing in life is not pretending that you know it all and understanding to know what you don't know. And also, like, don't fix something that's not broken. And just because a coach gets let go doesn't mean the team is in disarray. It means that, hey, sometimes they just need a different voice. You know, sometimes things are just coming a little bit stale that might cost you a little bit, you know, whatever that is. And I also believe, and I'm saying this because I am a coach, a lot of that is not so much on the coach. It's more on the whole group. It's a really interesting dynamic. It's kind of like this living organism that's going on. And sometimes changing out one person helps the group. But going back to your question, I think it's really important when you go in to take over a team is to really look at, okay, what was going on? What's the history of the team? And what are they doing well? Not what are they not doing well. Like, what are they really doing well? And whatever that is, leave it alone. Like, just leave it alone. Like, what? Why go in and change it and try to put your stamp on it? You're going to be able to put your stamp on where the team's deficient, where they need to readjust their steering wheel a little bit. So it's not real important just to go in and blow up the whole system, the way you communicate, the way you go about your day. Sometimes it's just a little bit of a tweak here and there. And if we want to talk right about Pete, the way they break out the puck in Dallas is different than they did last year. And I was actually listening to the game last night, and they were talking about Jamie Benn back in November was still just like saying it out loud, like, I'm just not sure that I should be doing this. But they've obviously all invested in it. And it's paying dividends.
And I, you know, as I was listening to you talk, Dallas, I was also thinking about the Florida Panthers, right? And what Paul Maurice goes in last year, they win the President's Trophy. We had Paul on the podcast before the playoffs began, and he talked a little bit about this, but the idea of this group needs to understand what hard hockey is about. And it didn't get hard for them last year until they got into the playoffs and they didn't know how to handle it. Are the Florida Panthers then the perfect example of a team we know is good and has talent, but just recognizing the deficiencies and going after those, as what you were just talking about?
Yeah, they're a really great study. So somebody should really look at that team in depth and do a week-long video series on them. Because I think Paul, like think about that. You go in, you take over the team, and they had won the President's Trophy, right? Like, the only way you can go is down. like you really got to do what he's doing now to have success. And the odds of that are against you. And then you think about like how they got into the playoffs. Like, they ended up getting in the playoffs because Pittsburgh couldn't get over Columbus and Chicago in the last two games. Like, that's how Florida got into the playoffs. And we were there kind of getting, I think we were in there getting closer to the deadline, maybe around there. And they were kind of going back and forth but them having to scratch and claw down the stretch, I think served them well. And you can pinpoint, you can go back, two things happened late in the season. Paul Maurice lost his absolute noodle on the bench, and he is he's a dear friend of mine, and I'm not speaking out of turn here. Like, he is an unbelievable communicator. He's really fast on his feet, and he knows every swear word in the book. And as much as on the bench there in Toronto, when he really gave it to his team, I think he was getting a lot of emotion out, but there was probably some calculation that he knew that he could affect his team in that moment to maybe push him over the edge. I think the second thing that happened, and it might've been the exact same day, is Keith Tkachuk, a guy that I played with a long time ago, a very hard player, said it out loud and just called the team soft. And said, hey, they're getting what they deserve. And with those two things going on and then them scratching and clawing down the stretch, I think it's really set them up well for the playoffs. Like, they've just knocked off what the best team ever, right? The Boston Bruins, and then a just highly powered Toronto team. Like, they're playing with house money now, and they truly believe that they can beat anyone.
You mentioned playing with Keith, and now Matthew is having an unbelievable year, Hart Trophy candidate year. I guess if Connor McDavid wasn't in the league, he would be the MVP. I'm curious, as a coach, when you watch him play, is there anybody in the NHL like him, or is he a complete unicorn?
Yeah, well, I think, you know what, I, off the top of my head, yeah, like, there's guys that play well like him, but they don't produce like him.
Yeah.
Like, he is like just an, he's fun to watch, and he just, you know, as a coach, so like, you know, you're not going to go out there and skate a shift as a coach. So you're watching all of this behind the scenes. You're watching your players act and react to things going on the ice. And I watch that young man. I know his dad very well. And I just stand there and I watch him, and you're just amazed at what a skill level he has. He has no fear in his game. Like, he goes to the net. He'll fight if he has to. So like, if you want to play a skilled game, he's fine with that. And then he has this ability to drive individuals and a bench crazy, like just crazy. And I think when you bring that all together, I guess the other guy that's, you know, really similar to him is like Marchand in Boston. He does it a little bit, you know, a different way, but he is certainly out there, like a guy that can throw down, he's physical, he wins puck battles, and then he can kill you on the scoreboard. Like, that's a really special player. And I'll tell you what, like, Bill Zito did a hell of a job there, like really recognizing what his team needed, you know, getting Bennett in there, who's a really gritty player. Those two guys playing together, like, they single-handedly drove Toronto crazy.
I do wonder if he's going to be able to do that against the Carolina Hurricanes, because they seem to be, I don't want to say robotic in their approach, because I think that would be, you know, termed as a negative, but it seems like no matter who's in their lineup, everything just stays the same. So they lose Svechnikov, and then Teravainen goes down, and we know about Pacioretty, and you wonder, are they going to be able to score? They're putting up 5 or 6 a night against the Devils, right? What do you make of Carolina and how they've been able to just stay the course through injuries, through illnesses to their goaltenders, to you know, through inconsistent goaltending play at times too?
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what. Number one, Rod Brendamore is a great coach, and he coaches from his heart. Like, it's as simple as that. And he believes in a system of play. And here's what I love about their team. Like, I respect that team so much. They're one of the teams that I most respect in the league. And it's because of this. Like, think about what most teams do, right? They play a certain way. And then at the deadline, they usually go add players that don't play like their team does. Oh, we need some grinders now. Oh, we need these defensive players. Like, you know, whatever it is, they go add these things. And it really looks good on paper, except for your team has been playing a certain way the whole year to have success. And then you get to the deadline, you're like, oh, we're going to add these other things. And it looks right, but it kind of goes against how you play. And if you look at Carolina, so it's right from the ownership to Don Waddell to their analytics department, Eric Salusti, like, they target players that they know that can play in their system, that aren't going to bring something different outside of their system, that play in their system. They always look for guys that can score, and they look for guys that can skate, and they look guys move the puck. They're not real concerned about anything else. And so I really believe you're right. Like, I'm really interested to see how they handle like Tkachuk and Bennett, because they are going to go out there and be physical. I do think they're probably just going to shrug their shoulders and go about their business. And so that will be interesting to see if they can get them a little agitated. But Carolina is robotic. And I'm not just talking about their NHL players that they target and they draft. Like, it's right through. It's a bunch of these little Carolina Hurricane robots. They just keep popping them in the lineup, popping them in the lineup. And I think I read that Teravainen might be close to coming back.
Yep.
That is awesome for them. So they're a very, very good team. And like a whole lot of teams, like, Dallas has got Ottinger. He's been pulled a couple times. I think goalie Bob there in Florida has not been pulled. You know, Carolina's had up and down goaltending. Like, the goaltending in the playoffs has been interesting too, but Carolina seems to get it done with whoever's in the net.
For so long, goaltending has been the key to the playoffs, right? You look at the playoffs and you look at teams and you're like, well, they got the best goaltender, so they're the team to beat. And then last year, Colorado wins with not the best goaltender. I think we can all agree on that. And then you look at this year, and Ottinger is the only one. Like, Bob didn't start. Lyon started. Vegas is on their second goalie through injury. Carolina's used both their goalies. Like, it's not the dominant guy anymore. Is this a permanent change in how we look at goaltending, or is this just a one or two off?
But you know what? My answer is I'm not sure, because like I think there are some really great goaltenders out there that aren't on really good teams. Like, I'll take the kid that I coached in Anaheim, like that John Gibson. I know his numbers don't look great, but that's because we are a rebuilding team. That kid is a stud goaltender. And so I'm just not sure. Maybe the goaltending out there right now, that there's like these dominant guys. I do think there's a whole bunch of like really good goaltenders. But once again, like it's been amazing, especially that second round. And you mentioned Vegas. Like, I think about Vegas and what they've been able to accomplish. They use five goalies this year during the regular season, and they're on their, well, you can, you know, Thompson's their one, and then it was a battle between Hill and Brossoit. Well, like, they're on their third goalie actually, and they're in the conference final. And, you know, I said it last week, like, some of these series are turning into the battle of the goaltending coaches. Like, head coaches kind of stay away from the goalies. You check in on them. You talk to them basically about other things other than their actual, the skill set of their position. And the goaltending coaches handle that. So a lot of these series now, where you see guys going in and out, guys getting hurt. You know, I think about Sean Burke there in Las Vegas. Like, that guy has done just an amazing job throughout this. But I'll tell you what, with the scores going one way and the other and guys getting hurt, it is a position that you better have depth at, or you can get yourself into a whole lot of trouble really fast.
I'm glad you brought up Sean Burke. Last one for me. I was going to ask you about him and the role of the goalie coach, especially in the playoffs, you know, but somebody brought up the other night, I was in Edmonton and I was covering that game. It was the end of the game. And somebody said, Sean Burke won this series for the Vegas Golden Knights, which to me was, you know, an overstatement because the players do it. But can that goalie coach make that big of a difference? Especially when you have, you know, one guy go out and another guy go in and he's got no playoff experience and whatnot. I mean, did Sean Burke have that big of a role in this?
I think he did. And you know what, like, you know, Berkey's not just a goaltending coach. Like, Berkey's been a GM candidate many times. And so I think Vegas is really, that was a great hire by Kelly McCrimmon. And when you think of like what coaches do, like the most important position on the ice is the goalie. It just is. Like, he's your last line of defense. He is the one player that can win a game by himself, like utterly by himself. And, you know, it's not the head coach coaching him. And then you've got assistant coaches that run a power play or run the penalty kill or run the defense or, you know, whatever that is. And, you know, they kind of need each other to do that. Like, hey, your power play might win you a game once in a while, unless you're Edmonton and it can win you a lot of games. But like those goaltending coaches are critical. And the it's amazing to watch the relationship that the goaltending coach has with his two guys, because like the head coach is got everybody, right? He's got a whole staff and he's got 23 players. And then the defenseman coach has his seven or eight guys, and maybe he's running the penalty kill. And then the forwards coach, he's got those like that. It's such a really tight relationship because there's just the two of them, right? Or maybe three. Well, I guess in Berkey's, he's got five. But it is such an important position. And I do believe that, you know, Sean Burke had a really big effect on that series.
Dallas, last one for me. It's a two-parter and they're very separate parts, but they'll be quick. One, I don't want you to tell me who's going to win the Stanley Cup because I don't want to put you in that position, but I do want you to tell me who you think the best team is right now out of the four that are left. And two, before you go, tell us a little bit about what's next for you. I know you've been doing some hockey night in Canada. What's on your list going forward?
Man, that's a tough one because these are like the four. Here's the biggest thing about the teams that are left. I really believe they are true teams. Like they are teams, like they have depth. You know, it's not like when you mention, let's say the Edmonton Oilers, you mentioned two players, right? But when you talk about Vegas or Florida or Dallas or Carolina, you talk about a whole bunch of players and you talk about a coach and you talk about their, like, it's an amazing group of four teams. And I'd have to probably, like, as much as, you know, I really keep an eye on Florida and I've been watching them through the playoffs and Carolina, like I know the teams in the West, the best. I do think that Vegas is the deepest of the group. I think they have the best team. Now the question mark there will be, you know, can their goaltending hold up? There's a whole lot of things that could go one way or the other. In the East, I just can't bet against Carolina. Like they are mechanical. Like I said, ownership, management through the system of play, their coach, like they are a plug and play hockey team. So it'll be interesting to see what happens, but I think there's going to be some great and some very long games come. As for me, yeah, I've been, dabbling in the TV world. I've really enjoyed it. I went and I did Sports Center one night for ESPN. I literally just finished 2 weeks on Hockey Night in Canada, which was just a blast. Those guys on the panel there are just incredible teammates. And for me, like, you know, there may be some opportunity there. I'm always going to want to coach. And whether that's coaching's coaching to me, whether I'm the head coach, go in as an assistant coach on a team, go to the American League and be a head coach. I'm also looking at opportunities there. And then the last thing for me is I've done a whole lot in this game. And, you know, sometimes people just go, oh, well, he's just a coach. Well, I've scouted. I started the player development program with the Toronto Maple Leafs. I've handled budgets. I've hired people. I've fired people. I've done a lot. And so there is a little bit of an urge too, to take a different approach and maybe get in on the management side somewhere. So I'm kind of leaving all my options open. It's a really fun time in the league right now to watch the playoffs. And then all of that personal stuff will heat up one way or the other here over the next month.
Well, we appreciate you jumping on with us. You're certainly good at this media stuff. This was a great segment for us. So thank you so much.
Hey, anytime, guys. I'm here if you need me.
Well, we didn't lie. That was really good stuff there from Dallas Eakins. So we thank him for joining us. So again, the conference final round begins Thursday, the Eastern Conference final, Carolina, Florida in Raleigh. That one's, I believe, 8 p.m. Eastern. It's on TNT in the U.S., obviously Sportsnet, CBC in Canada. And then on Friday, Game 1 of the Western Conference Final at T-Mobile Arena, Vegas and Dallas. That one's 8:30 p.m. Eastern, and it's on ESPN. And the Toronto Maple Leafs have begun their offseason. And that's where we should go now, because it was very interesting stuff. coming out of their baggy day, breakup day, whatever you want to call it, Shawn. And I think we start, there's we could start in multiple ways with the Toronto Maple Leafs and the, you know, is the fallout from finally winning a round, first time since 2004, but then losing in five games to the Florida Panthers. And it makes for what was an exciting season become a disappointing season. How quickly that can happen, right? That, you know, oh, we finally win the round and then we get losing five and it's, you know, a missed opportunity and all that stuff. So we can go to Kyle Dubas or we can go to Austin Matthews. And I think Kyle Dubas to me is more interesting because his immediate future is more in doubt right now. The general manager there talked about it. He does not have a contract right now for next season. And we're not 100% sure if he wants a contract for next season. And I thought that was a terrific moment of honesty from a guy who's throughout this postseason has really shown his emotions, whether it's water bottle throwing, yelling and screaming in the, you know, his, what he looks like in the press box or his suite, as the game's going on, you love that passion. And now he's got to figure out if continuing in this role is right for his family, really. And I thought that was, you know, a moment of honesty and a real true emotional moment for Kyle Dubas. And I appreciated it, Shawn. I appreciate the honesty that he delivered in that moment.
Yeah. Well, I think we forget this is a business populated by humans, right? It's a business. It's cutthroat. It's about winning. But the people who go about doing it are human. They're like you or they're like me. Like, they have lives, they have families, they have people who love them. And it's hard, right? It's hard, especially, you know, Dallas talked about it a little bit, how hard it is for a Canadian team to win because of the pressure on them from the media, from social media, from the fans. Everything's a little more pronounced in Canada, and then it's a little more pronounced in Toronto. And Kyle's lived under an enormous amount of stress forever since he walked in. Like, he was not the popular choice when we look back, right? He had no experience. He was coming out of junior hockey. Like, it was a non-traditional call, and it was not universally accepted by the Toronto fan base. He's certainly done some good things. He's done some things that I think will be questioned, and, you know, good for him in wanting to take care of his family and wanting his family to be emotionally healthy. It's got to be incredibly difficult, especially when you have kids and, you know, they're exposed to it wherever they go. Oh, your dad stinks. He made this trade. He didn't do this. They're out of the playoffs. So there is burnout, and it's happened. It happened to Paul Maurice, right? And now he's back and he's in the playoffs. I think sometimes there's that need to take a step away. So it'll be an interesting few weeks for sure as they sort out his future, because they need to do that and decide, you know, in which direction they want to go, because then whoever is that GM, whether it's Kyle Dubas or somebody new, and is it still Brendan Shanahan ahead of him and whatever, then you decide on the coach and then you decide on the players, right? You talked about Austin Matthews. He's going into the last year of his contract. If he's not signed relatively soon after July 1st, that's going to become a long-running soap opera. I don't think that's something they need. And Kyle said, before he said, I don't know if I want to come back, he said, if I am back, everything's on the table.
Yeah, that's the first time he said that I can remember. It's the first time where he has hinted that maybe this core needs a shakeup. And so if he's the guy that returns, or whoever it is that comes in to do this job, I 100% agree with that. You know, you look at it and you say, you can't just keep running it back the same way, hoping for a different outcome. Something has to change. It just cannot always be the coach gets changed or this, that, and the other. Something within the makeup of this team has to change. Look at the Florida Panthers. They're the perfect example, right? Jonathan Huberdeau drafted, developed, had a huge season, 115 points with the Panthers last season. They win the President's Trophy. Everything looks great. They lose in the second round. They take their time. And Kyle Dubas talked about this, right? He referenced this. They take their time, and then they make the big move. And there's been no more of an impactful move that any team has made in a very long time than that move of trading Huberdeau and getting Matthew Tkachuk back, right? I mean, obviously, he's one of the biggest reasons why they are where they are right now. And they took a hit in the regular season when they did it, but it's better now. And that's when it has to be better. It has to be better now. You have to be good enough just to get in and get lucky sometimes. And that's where it comes in. And they need that change, whether it's moving Mitch Marner, honestly, and it's no offense against Mitchell Marner or anybody like that. He's the guy I would look at to trade. Okay. He's the one that I would look at to trade. Although he touches so many areas for that team. I just think that he's that the shakeup, you get so much for him too. Austin Matthews, 1 year left on his deal. There's a lot of questions there. He says he wants to come back. That's well and good. He's got to sign the contract. You know, like it's all well and good to say it. You got to sign it. There's some shakeup that needs to be done there in Toronto for this team to maybe take a step back in order to take three steps forward. There's history of that across the National Hockey League.
Yeah, and something needs to change. And to me, it's culturally, right? Like, again, there's so much angst in Leafdom, right? The fans are angst-ridden. They're inconsolable. Is the team? I didn't see it. I didn't see it in breakdown day. I saw a bunch of players say, we love it here. The culture's great. We want to be a part of this. I want to come back. I want to do this. Not once did I hear somebody say, this stunk.
Yeah.
This is horrible. I'm gutted. Leon Draisaitl said
Look at Leon Draisaitl. I was about to say that. Did you see Leon Draisaitl after game six? Guy was almost in tears. Hood on. He didn't want to be anywhere but where he was talking about this.
And look, I'll give him credit. That's in the moment. And I'm sure there was a lot of that in the locker room after game five in Toronto. And they had a day, 2 days to compose themselves, and nobody wants to come out and look like an emotional basket case. But it was a little too comfortable to me. Like, I want to see somebody lose their noodle, as mm-hmm. Dallas Eakins said in talking about Paul Maurice. You know, I want somebody to be pissed off.
Yeah. No, and I think it does come back. It's a cultural thing. There, look, it's going to be a very interesting couple of weeks now in Toronto to see what happens. And, you know, I think it'll be covered. Pretty sure that there'll be media coverage of it.
We have Mike Zeisberger, a frequent guest on this show, who will be doing a little of the Eastern Conference Final, but will also be having his fingers in the Toronto pie as they make news. And it's across the board. It literally is Shanny, Dubas, Keefe, top players. They don't have a bottom six. No. They're all free agents.
They're all free agents. I know.
Like, they literally do not – they're not bringing them all back. They can't, right? Ryan O'Reilly's probably gone, Nola Chari, all those guys. Their bottom six are all free agents. So do you have six guys with the Marlies that can come up and do that? I don't think so. So you need to remake this team and you need to figure out. And again, you know, you go to what Dallas Eakins said, and like, who are you? Those players have to be who you are.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And to me, Toronto was kind of that mix, right? They went out and they said, we needed a bunch of grinders. And they went out and they got him. And look, Ryan O'Reilly helped them. I think he helped them in the room more than anything. And to me, that's the value. Like, he gave them that sandpaper that they needed in their own room. Like, hey, guys, this isn't good enough. It didn't work, but at least he tried. They need to identify who they are, and they need to become comfortable in who they are. And then they need to build their team around that.
Again, we'll see where it goes from there with Toronto. Back to the playoffs, Sean. We have the Conn Smythe Trophy Roundtable coming up on NHL.com, and I'm curious where your thought is. And look, when we do these things, we try to spread it out a little bit, because especially this year, there's just a number of different candidates. There's not just one guy or two guys that have dominated, that have taken off here through two rounds in the playoffs. My choice was Miro Heiskanen, and he doesn't even have a goal, but I still went with Miro Heiskanen. The dude played 32 minutes last night. You know, in game seven against Seattle, he played 32 minutes. And I think it was his third time in the series playing 30 or more minutes against Seattle. The one game where he had to leave the game because he got the puck in the face, the Dallas Stars completely imploded immediately after he left. He's that important of a player for them. He has 9 assists, which I think right now is second among defensemen in the playoffs behind Evan Bouchard, who gets them all on the power play anyway. No goals, but Miro Heiskanen, their Dallas Stars are nowhere near the conference final without Miro Heiskanen. Rupe Hintz is having a great run. Joe Pavelski's got 8 goals in 8 games. Jake Ottinger came back. He finished the series against Minnesota strong. He finished the series against Seattle strong. But there's nobody that's been as important to his team Well, arguably, nobody that's been as important to his team as Miro Heiskanen, and the guy doesn't even have a goal. So he's the guy I went with in the debate. I could easily have gone with Matthew Tkachuk. That would have been, you know, somebody did. I think it was, you know, Tom Galitti did, and that makes sense. You can go that route. There's a lot of different candidates, but Heiskanen was mine.
Look, it's really difficult. I think there's two or three guys on each team. I think when you get this deep, you look at it and you say, oh, it's this guy or this guy, right? So, like, I would argue Pavelski on Dallas, right? Because the point is to score goals, and nobody scored bigger goals than him. So is he the most valuable? I mean, you take 8 goals away from Dallas in their home right now. So, you know, and then you, to me, it's always about the under the radar guys, right? Because you kind of look and you say, oh, it's this, it's Bob, it's Tkachuk, it's this guy, it's that guy. Like, to me, Jacob Slavin needs to be in this conversation. Like, he was so good against Jack Hughes, and I know Jack Hughes was a little banged up, and, you know, probably shouldn't have played in Game 5. But even before that, like, just dominating. Chances for and against were like 25-1. He just plays so well, and he lets Brent Burns do Brent Burns things without fear of being burnt. There's those guys littered across the 4 teams that are left.
Jordan Martinuk. Look at Jordan Martinuk.
Yeah, no. I mean,
10 points.
Second round MVP.
Yeah, that's right. Didn't produce in the first round.
Yeah, so it's a great debate. That story's going to go up a little later today when we get done with this podcast. I need to go put it together and edit it. I haven't made my pick yet because I'm going to have to wait to see who everybody else picks, and then I'm going to come out of left field and not be repetitive. It'll be a surprise pick. We can discuss it next week when we're halfway through the conference finals. But before we go on to other things that we need to do before we finish up, I just want to make a shout out to the Seattle Kraken.
Yes.
They gave Dallas everything they wanted and more. They surprised countless people, including myself, who did not think they would get out of the first round. They almost got out of the second round. They are, you know, we talk about the teams that are left being teams. The biggest team of them all just left the tournament 1 goal short in Game 7. Dave Haxtell did an unbelievable job. They played as a team. It is going to be unbelievably beneficial to them to have gone through this, to understand what it means to be in the playoffs. But they're built for the playoffs. So when they come back, they're built to play this tournament, and they have a better understanding of it now. And they're in a position to be good for at least the short term.
Yeah, they got a lot of guys still signed. But they have 18 goal scorers, something like that, in the playoffs. Nick Kotsanika, or Nicholas J. Kotsanika, as he goes on his byline, our columnist wrote a really good story on the Kraken after the Game 7 loss. It's on NHL.com right now, really detailing that. And a big part of that story was at the end where, you know, what they did for hockey in Seattle, putting it on the map. I mean, you can be a team, you can get a team, but until that team really makes its mark, it's not totally on the map. It's on the map right now. It took 1 year for Vegas. It took 2 years for Seattle. Vegas obviously went to the Stanley Cup final, but Seattle 1 goal away from getting into the conference final with the team that they had. 100 point season, really remarkable season. And you saw it, and Nick wrote about this. You saw it. Look, it's 2-0. There's less than a minute to go, and less than 30 seconds to go. They could have easily been like, all right, it's not happening. And they score a goal. They managed to get one, and it makes it dicey in those last 18 seconds or whatever it was, right? I mean, it makes it dicey for the home team, the Dallas Stars, and Dallas survived. But look, it kind of says a lot about who the Seattle Kraken are that they continued on the way they did and get that goal late in the game to at least make it interesting.
The one thing I was thinking as I watched that Game 7, as I watched that whole series, Adam Larson 1-for-1. Not so outrageous anymore. He's turned into a hell of a player.
He's a heck of a player. He really is. He is a terrific defenseman. All right. Before we get out of here, we got to do predictions. And this will be the last thing we do.
Wait, no. Before we do predictions, we got to do one other thing.
Okay.
Congratulations to our good friend, regular appearer on the podcast, Keith Jones.
Oh, yeah.
The new big man. I don't even know his real title. I'm going to call him Big Man. The new big man in Philadelphia. I believe he's president of hockey operations or something like that. But he's the new big man. He's the guy in Philly. And there's not a better the guy in Philly than Keith Jones.
Yeah, and a big job. That is a huge job.
Yeah, he's ready for it. Judging by his performance on our podcast, I think he's going to be a huge success.
Well, there's no doubt he knows the league and he knows what's going on around the league. So, yeah, big for him. You're right. Glad you got that in there. All right. Now, predictions. I'll let you go first.
The East is really hard for me. That was the harder of the two. I think in the end, Carolina is going to win and it's going to be in seven. They're mirror images of each other. And I want to pick Florida because of Matthew Tkachuk, but I don't know that he's going to be as effective. So that's my prediction. Out West, I like Vegas. I like Vegas to win the whole thing. I saw them for two rounds or parts of two rounds. They beat a really good, offensively incredible Edmonton team. They shut them down at 5-on-5. They shut down the two best players in the world at 5-on-5. I don't see anybody left in the tournament that poses that kind of threat to them. If they can remain disciplined, and I don't think there's anybody in the tournament left who can force them to take penalties like Edmonton did. They only need average goaltending. They're like, to me, they're like Colorado now. They only need average goaltending to win the whole thing. So for me, Vegas over Dallas, again, really long series. And then, you know, if it goes my way, it's Vegas and Carolina in the final. And to me, it's still Vegas.
All right. So I'm going Carolina in seven for a lot of the same reasons you gave. And I'm going to go Dallas in seven, too. I think both series go seven. I like Dallas in seven over Vegas. I think Jake Ottinger makes a big difference. And I think you're right. They were able to shut down the two best players, arguably the two best players in the world, at 5-on-5. The problem is Dallas is deeper. Dallas goes deeper than the Edmonton Oilers do. And so I like Dallas to pull it out in a game seven, which would be in Las Vegas, too, by the way, which would be something. So Dallas, Carolina for me. And I mean, if we're going to go pick a Stanley Cup winner at this point, I would probably at this point, I kind of got to go with Jake Ottinger. And he thinks that they can win it all. And I think that they can win it all, too. So Dallas, Carolina in the Stanley Cup final. Dallas wins it all. We'll revisit that, though. Maybe my pick will change by the time we get to the Stanley Cup final.
Nobody will remember, Dan. It's all right.
It's on the record.
No, you can change it.
Well, anyway, listen, game one, Eastern Conference Final, Florida, Carolina in Raleigh on Thursday. Game one, Western Conference Final, Vegas, Dallas in Las Vegas on Friday. Enjoy the hockey.